Oh, Leviticus, I was just looking for you. I received this post-it note from your secretary and wanted to clarify a few of the points on it. Do you have a moment?
Well, hello, Saul. Yes, I have a minute, but make it short. I have a brunch with Hitler.
Well, it's about this Leviticus 20:13 business, about the homosexuals. My brother-in-law's a homosexual, and that's your nephew, Leviticus.
Ah, yes. One of my favorites. 20:13. I wrote this one myself with little from God. He was very busy cleaning a toilet at the time. If a man lies with a male as with a woman, both of them shall be put to death for their abominable deed. They have forfeited their lives. Now that's a keeper, Saul. I want to keep that one in. It's a good rule.
Well, sorry to burst your bubble, Leviticus, but 1,500 species of animals that Noah collected are homosexual. Does that mean we have to kill all of them too? Did God put them on that Noah's Ark? Just for us to kill them now? It seems pretty irrational, don't you think?
I don't see anything hypocritical about it, and if you do, maybe you should just keep your mouth shut and go along with the crowd. Don't cause a stir. Let me dictate. I'm Leviticus. Now is anything else on your mind, Saul? I told you, I'm meeting Hitler for brunch.
Well, yes, as a matter of fact, there are a few other points I'd like to discuss with you, like what you said here in the memo. You said here in Leviticus 19:27, do not clip your hair at the temples, nor trim the edges of your beard. Many of the men like to be close-shaven for the women, and doesn't this sort of go against the whole free will thing arranged by God at the beginning? This seems to be very hypocritical again. Don't you think so, Leviticus?
I don't believe there's any hypocritical nature involved here. To tell you that you're free to do whatever you wish to do, and then instruct you on how to groom yourself is perfectly in accord with itself. A perfect balance. Wouldn't you say so, Saul? Or do you want this to get out publicly? That might not be so good for you. I'd keep this one under your yarmulke.
Okay, well, we'll move on then. Well, there's this one. In your note of Leviticus 21:9, you said, a priest's daughter who loses her honor by committing fornication and thereby dishonors her father also shall be burned to death. People are having a lot of issues with this, Leviticus. I don't think this one will fly. I mean, there are many priests in the area, and as you know, like Beth Ann, your own daughter-in-law, she's married to a priest and has a child, and that would mean that you would have to burn your own daughter-in-law. Should we burn your own daughter-in-law, then?
Actually, I'm thinking of doing a rewrite of this whole thing. I frankly have a name. I'm gonna call it the New Testament, and some of these notes, just keep them on the side to yourself, Saul, and I'll consider them when I do my redaction of the first version. Nothing's perfect the first time, well, nothing but God, and, oh yeah, that's right, he wrote it. So, I guess God's not perfect either. Let's move along, Saul.
People are having a very difficult time with this little note that you left me, as I've discussed it with the wife and kids, and we're a little dismayed. We passed it over to Paul's house and to Maury, you know Maury Rosenberg, and he gave his opinion, and this is a bit harsh. You're 26:21-22. You say, if even then you remain hostile toward me and refuse to obey, I will inflict you with 7 more disasters for your sin. Well, I will release wild animals that will kill your children and destroy your cattle, so your numbers will dwindle and your roads will be deserted. That hardly seems logical. If you and God created all of this, why would you want us to destroy it? It again seems very hypocritical, and why would you want to kill children and unrelated animals just to inflict things to dry up for a community? That seems pretty ridiculous, childish, and hostile. That sounds like Bill, the neighbor next door, who throws rocks through our window when he's unhappy with the lawnmower running very early in the morning. It sounds very creepy, Leviticus, and I think it's very hypocritical to kill children. Wouldn't you agree on that one?
I don't see any hypocrisy in creating something that I love and care for to kill it. I think that's my general nature. I made a beautiful, beautiful glass vase last week, and after I admired it for a few moments, I smashed it onto the floor. It was very satisfying. I don't find that hypocritical. Move along, Saul.
I'll move along after this last question, Leviticus, if you'll indulge me. And I know you may not be able to answer this because you're no longer too close of friends with Matthew after your falling out at that beer fest, but I think Matthew might be smoking crack or perhaps getting into the sacramental wine, he writes. Then the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their magnificence. Is this lunatic suggesting that the earth is flat? Even that he can see the entire world from the top of a mountain? It sounds like he's using drugs again. I think there's something wrong with him. Certainly we know that the earth is an orb, a sphere. So Matthew must be doing something irregular. Wouldn't you think so, Leviticus?
Yes. He was high as a kite when he wrote that nonsense. Yes, Saul. God and I have arranged for Matthew to visit the Betty Ford Clinic. He'll be going next Thursday, after the intervention we have scheduled for next Wednesday. You can come if you like. Now I really must be going, Saul. As I said, I'm meeting Hitler for brunch, and you know how he gets.
God damn it! Where is that goddamn son of a bitch, Leviticus? That son of a bitch is always late! Ugh!